Hello friends, today in this lecture we will study about cell signaling and signal transduction. Each cell in a multicellular animal is bombarded with chemical signals that are made by other cells, and this is how communication occurs at cell level by different signaling molecules. Signals that regulate cell metabolism, alter or maintain its differentiated state determine whether it should divide and dictate whether it will live or die. The word signals in this context refers to nothing more than chemical molecules that are floating around the cells. In general, these signals bind to cell surface receptors that activate several intracellular signaling pathways so that the intracellular signals generated from different receptors will interact with one another in complex ways. Cell signaling affects virtually every aspect of cell structure and function. Cell signaling is also intimately involved in the regulation of cell growth and division. This makes the study of cell signaling crucially important for understanding how a cell can lose the ability to control cell division and develop into a malignant tumor. The signal transduction is used to refer to a broad area of cellular biology research involving topics such as the chemical signals used by cells, how these signals are received, how a cell interprets them, and the ways in which cellular machinery can be used to respond. How does a cell integrate all of this information so as to behave in a way that is optimal for the animal as a whole? The task of understanding how a cell manages this feat seems overwhelming, even in the relatively simple case of bacterial chemotaxis, where there are relatively few components, all of which are probably known. The complexities of the interactions are still too great to be easily visualized and completely understood at present. How can we hope to understand the much more complex network of intracellular signaling pathways in animal cells where hundreds of components, many still undiscovered, are involved? The intracellular signaling pathways, seen as a whole, form a highly interconnected network in which signals are processed along multiple parallel routes that interact with one another. One can therefore learn about the behavior of signaling networks by comparing them to other highly interconnected networks. An overview of cellular signaling pathways. Cell signaling is initiated with the release of messenger molecule by a cell that is engaged in sending messages to other cells in the body. Cells can only respond to an extracellular message if they express receptors that are specifically recognized and bind that particular messenger molecule. In most cases, the messenger molecule or ligand binds to a receptor at the extracellular surface of the responding cell. This interaction causes a signal to be relayed across the membrane to the receptor's cytoplasmic domain. Once it has reached the inner surface of the plasma membrane, there is a route by which the signal is transmitted into the cell interior, where it elicits the appropriate response. The particular route taken depends on the type of receptor that is activated. One type of receptor transmits a signal from its cytoplasmic domain to a nearby enzyme, which generates a second messenger. Because it brings about the cellular response by generating a second messenger, the enzyme responsible is referred to as an effector. Second messenger. They are small substances that typically activate or inactivate specific proteins. Depending on its chemical structure, a second messenger may diffuse through the cytosol or remain embedded in the lipid bilayer of a membrane. Another type of receptor transmits a signal by transforming its cytoplasmic domain into a recruiting station for cellular signaling proteins. Whether the signal is transmitted by a second messenger or by protein recruitment, the outcome is similar. A protein that is positioned at the top of an intracellular signaling pathway is activated. Signaling pathways are the information superhighways of the cell. Signals transmitted along such signaling pathways ultimately reach target proteins involved in basic cellular processes. Depending on the type of cell and message, the response initiated by the target protein may involve a change in gene expression, an alteration of the activity of metabolic enzymes, a reconfiguration of the cytoskeleton, an increase or decrease in cell mobility, a change in ion permeability, activation of DNA synthesis, or even the death of the cell. Virtually every activity in which a cell is engaged is regulated by signals originating at the cell surface. This overall process, in which information carried by extracellular messenger molecules is translated into changes that occur inside a cell, is referred to as signal transduction. Finally, signaling has to be terminated. This is important because cells have to be responsive to additional messages that they may receive. The first order of business is to eliminate the extracellular messenger molecule. To do this, certain cells produce extracellular enzymes that destroy specific extracellular messengers. In other cases, activated receptors are internalized. Once inside the cell, the receptor may be degraded together with its ligand, which can leave the cell with decreased sensitivity to subsequent stimuli. Alternatively, receptor and ligand may be separated within an endosome, after which the ligand is degraded and the receptor is returned to the cell surface. Signaling molecules and their role in cell functions. Signaling molecules are amino acids and amino acid derivatives. Examples include glutamate, glycine, acetylcholine, epinephrine, dopamine, and thyroid hormones. These molecules act as neurotransmitters and hormones. Gases such as NO, nitric oxide, and CO, carbon monoxide, as well as steroids, which are derived from cholesterol, also act as signaling molecules. Steroid hormones regulate sexual differentiation, pregnancy, carbohydrate metabolism, and excretion of sodium and potassium ions. Finally, a large number of proteins are secreted into the extracellular environment, where they are involved in regulating processes such as cell division, differentiation, the immune response, or cell death and cell survival. Receptors bind their signaling molecules with high affinity and translate this interaction at the outer surface of the cell into changes that takes place on the inside of the cell. The receptors that have evolved to mediate signal transduction are indicated below. G protein coupled receptors, or GPCRs. GPCRs are a huge family of receptors that contain 7 transmembrane helices. These receptors translate the binding of extracellular signaling molecules into the activation of GTP binding proteins. They are so named because they interact with G proteins. Members of the GPCR superfamily are also referred to as 7 transmembrane receptors because they contain 7 transmembrane helices. Thousands of different GPCRs have been identified in organisms ranging from yeast to flowering plants and mammals that together regulate an extraordinary spectrum of cellular processes. In fact, GPCRs constitute the single largest superfamily of proteins encoded by animal genomes. Included among the natural ligands that bind to GPCRs are a diverse array of hormones, both plant and animal, neurotransmitters, opium derivatives, chemoattractants, example, molecules that attract phagocytic cells of the immune system, odorants and tastants, molecules detected by olfactory and gustatory receptors, eliciting the senses of smell and taste, and photons. G protein structure. G protein coupled receptors normally have the following topology. Their amino terminus is present on the outside of the cell. The seven helices that traverse the plasma membrane are connected by loops of varying length, and the carboxy terminus is present on the inside of the cell. There are three loops present on the outside of the cell that together form the ligand binding site. There are also three loops present on the cytoplasmic side of the plasma membrane that provide binding sites for intracellular signaling proteins. G proteins bind to the third intracellular loop. Finally, there is a growing number of proteins that bind to the carboxy termini of GPCRs. Many of these proteins act as molecular scaffolds that link receptors to various signaling proteins and effectors present in the cell. Rhodopsin has an unusually stable structure for a GPCR, owing to the fact that its ligand, a retinal group, is permanently bound to the protein, and the protein molecule can only exist in a single conformation in the absence of a stimulus, that is, in the dark. Beginning in 2007, as a result of years of efforts by a number of research groups, a flurry of GPCR crystal structures appeared in the literature. For the most part, these structures reveal the GPCR is in the inactive state. The inactive conformation is stabilized by non-covalent interactions between specific residues in the transmembrane helices. Ligand binding disturbs these interactions, thereby causing the receptor to assume an active conformation. This requires rotations and shifts of the transmembrane helices relative to each other. Because they are attached to the cytoplasmic loops, rotation or movement of these transmembrane helices causes changes in the conformation of the cytoplasmic loops. This in turn leads to an increase in the affinity of the receptor for a G protein that is present on the cytoplasmic surface of the plasma membrane. As a consequence, the ligand bound receptor forms a receptor G protein complex. The interaction with the receptor induces a conformational change in the subunit of a G protein, causing the release of GDP, which is followed by binding of GTP. In the inactivated state, a single receptor can activate a number of G protein molecules, providing a means of signal amplification. Discovery of G protein. Heterotrimeric G proteins were discovered, purified, and characterized by Martel Rodbell and his colleagues at the National Institute of Health and Alfred Gilman and colleagues at the University of Virginia. These proteins are referred to as G proteins because they bind guanine nucleotides, either GDP or GTP. They are described as heterotrimeric because all of them consist of three different polypeptide subunit. This property distinguishes them from small monomeric G proteins. The guanine nucleotide binding site is present on the G subunit. Replacement of GDP by GTP following interaction with an activated GPCR results in a conformational change in the G subunit. In its GTP bound conformation, the G subunit has a low affinity for G, leading to its dissociation from the complex. Each dissociated G subunit with GTP attached is free to activate an effector protein such as adenylyl cyclase as shown in the figure. In this case, activation of the effector leads to the production of the second messenger, cyclic AMP. Second messengers in turn activate one or more cellular signaling proteins. A G protein is said to be on when its subunit is bound to GTP. G subunits can turn themselves off by hydrolysis of GTP to GDP and inorganic phosphate. This results in a conformational change causing a decrease in the affinity for the effector and an increase in the affinity for the subunit. Thus, following hydrolysis of GTP, the G subunit will dissociate from the effector and reassociate with the subunit to reform the inactive heterotrimeric G protein. In a sense, heterotrimeric G proteins function as molecular timers. They are turned on by the interaction with an activated receptor and turn themselves off by hydrolysis of bound GTP after a certain amount of time has passed. While they are active, G subunits can turn on downstream effectors. Heterotrimeric G proteins come in four forms: GS, GQ, GI, and G12-13. This classification is based on the G subunits and the effectors to which they couple. The particular response elicited by an activated GPCR depends on the type of G protein with which it interacts. Although some GPCRs can interact with different G proteins and trigger more than one physiologic response, GS family members couple receptors to adenylyl cyclase. Adenylyl cyclase is activated by GTP bound GS subunits. GQ family members contain G subunits that activate PLC, phospholipase C. PLC hydrolyzes phosphatidyl inositol biphosphate, producing inositol triphosphate, PI3, and diacylglycerol, DAG. Activated GI subunits function by inhibiting adenylyl cyclase. G12-13 members are less well characterized than the other G protein families, although their inappropriate activation has been associated with excessive cell proliferation and malignant transformation. Following its dissociation from the G subunit, the complex also has a signaling function and it can couple to at least four different types of effectors: PLC, potassium ion channels, adenylyl cyclase, and PI3 kinase, also known as phosphatidyl inositol 4,5 bisphosphate 3 kinase. Termination of the response. We have seen that ligand binding results in receptor activation. The activated receptors turn on G proteins and G proteins turn on effectors. To prevent overstimulation, receptors have to be blocked from continuing to activate G proteins. To regain sensitivity to future stimuli, the receptor, the G protein, and the effector must all be returned to their inactive state. Desensitization, the process that blocks active receptors from turning on additional G proteins, takes place in two steps. In the first step, the cytoplasmic domain of the activated GPCR is phosphorylated by a specific type of kinase called G protein coupled receptor kinase, GRK. GRKs form a small family of serine threonine protein kinases that specifically recognize activated GPCRs. Phosphorylation of the GPCR binds to proteins called arrestins. Arrestins form a small group of proteins that bind to GPCRs and compete for binding with heterotrimeric G proteins. As a consequence, Eristin binding prevents the further activation of additional G proteins. This action is termed desensitization because the cell stops responding to the stimulus, while that stimulus is still acting on the outer surface of the cell. Desensitization is one of the mechanisms that allows a cell to respond to a change in its environment rather than continuing to fire endlessly in the presence of an unchanging environment. The importance of desensitization is illustrated by the observation that mutations that interfere with phosphorylation of rhodopsin by a GRK lead to the death of the photoreceptor cells in the retina. This type of retinal cell death is thought to be one of the causes of blindness resulting from the disease retinitis pigmentosa. While they are bound to phosphorylated GPCRs, Eristin molecules are also capable of binding to clathrin molecules that are situated in clathrin-coated pits. The interaction between bound Eristin and clathrin promotes the uptake of phosphorylated GPCRs into the cell by endocytosis. Depending on the circumstances, receptors that have been removed from the surface by endocytosis may be dephosphorylated and returned to the plasma membrane. Alternatively, internalized receptors are degraded in the lysosomes. If receptors are degraded, the cells lose at least temporarily sensitivity for the ligand in question. If receptors are returned to the cell surface, the cells remain sensitive to the ligand. Signaling by the activated G subunit is terminated by a less complex mechanism. The bound GTP molecule is simply hydrolyzed to GDP. Thus, the strength and duration of the signal are determined in part by the rate of GTP hydrolysis by the G subunit. G subunits possess a weak GTPase activity which allows them to slowly hydrolyze the bound GTP and inactivate themselves. Termination of the response is accelerated by regulators of G protein signaling, RGS. The interaction with an RGS protein increases the rate of GTP hydrolysis by the G subunit. Once the GTP is hydrolyzed, the GDP reassociates with the G subunits to reform the inactive trimeric complex as discussed. This returns the system to the resting state. The mechanism for transmitting signals across the plasma membrane by G proteins is of ancient evolutionary origin and is highly conserved. This is illustrated by an experiment in which yeast cells were genetically engineered to express a receptor for the mammalian hormone somatostatin, growth hormone. When these yeast cells were treated with somatostatin, the mammalian receptors at the cell surface interacted with the yeast heterotrimeric G proteins at the inner surface of the membrane and triggered a response leading to proliferation of the yeast cells. Protein kinase C has a number of important roles in cellular growth and differentiation, cellular metabolism, cell death, and transcriptional activation. The apparent importance of protein kinase C in growth control is seen in studies with a group of powerful plant compounds called forbol esters that resemble DAG. These compounds activate protein kinase C in a variety of cultured cells, causing them to lose growth control and behave temporarily as malignant cells. When the forbol ester is removed from the medium, the cells recover their normal growth properties. In contrast, cells that have been genetically engineered to constitutively express protein kinase C exhibit a permanent malignant phenotype in cell culture and can cause tumors in susceptible mice. Finally, application of forbol esters to the skin in combination with certain other chemicals will cause the formation of skin tumors. Inositol 1,4-5 triphosphate, IP3, is a sugar phosphate, a small water soluble molecule capable of rapid diffusion through the interior of the cell. IP3 molecules formed at the membrane diffuse into the cytosol and binds to a specific IP3 receptor located at the surface of the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. The smooth endoplasmic reticulum is a site of calcium storage in a variety of cells. The IP3 receptor also functions as a tetrameric calcium channel. Binding of IP3 opens the channel, allowing calcium ions to diffuse into the cytoplasm. Calcium ions can also be considered as intracellular or second messengers because they bind to various target molecules, triggering specific responses. In the two examples used above, contraction of smooth muscle cell and exocytosis of histamine-containing secretory granules in a mast cell, both are triggered by elevated calcium levels. So too is the response of a liver cell to the hormone vasopressin, the same hormone that has antidiuretic activity in the kidney. Vasopressin binds to its receptor at the liver cell surface and causes a series of IP3 mediated bursts of calcium ion release, which appear as oscillations of free cytosolic calcium. The frequency and intensity of such oscillations may encode information that governs the cell's specific response. Summary. In this lecture, we have seen that each cells have different functional activity. They are very specific to their work in our body. At required time, these cells send different signaling molecules like hormones, proteins, and their derivatives, and also in the form of gases like nitric oxide and carbon monoxide. These cell signals are very important to our body because they decide cell functions like cell metabolism, differentiation, cell division, and apoptosis, etc. These signals are in two forms: stimulatory and inhibitory. They bind to its receptor, that is G protein coupled receptors, GPCR, and generates cascade pathway by forming second messenger like cyclic AMP. Heterotrimeric G proteins were discovered, purified, and characterized by Martin Rodbell and his colleagues. G proteins come in four forms: GS, GQ, GI and G12-13. Adenyl cyclase is activated by GTP bound GS subunits. GQ family members contain G subunits that activate PLC, phospholipase C. Activated GI subunits function by inhibiting adenyl cyclase. G12-13 members are less well characterized and are found to be associated with excessive cell proliferation and malignant transformation. G protein coupled receptor kinase, GRK, and arrestins work for the termination of GPCR. There are many other second messengers like calcium ions, IP3, and DAG. I hope this session has been useful in understanding cell signaling. Thank you.